When I think of my grandmother, I think of a person who is strong, determined, giving, and resilient. I've always wondered what it was that led my grandmother to have such a passionate sense of self. Was it her upbringing, her culture, and the country she came from? Was it the political unrest she had to flee from to ensure safety for herself and her family? Or was it coming to a country that only just opened the doors to a non-white population and navigating a whole new way of life? My grandma was born on the 21st of February in 1938 into a family of four children, and they lived very close to Montevideo, the capital of Uruguay. She spoke of a very happy childhood, having lived in farmhouses and city homes, and was also given the opportunity to study primary education to become a teacher. My grandma grew up in a period when Uruguay was experiencing an economic boom, as European nations began buying agricultural products such as wool and beef. Unemployment virtually disappeared, and this period resulted in Uruguay having the highest income per capita in Latin America. However, after the Korean War ended in the 1950s, European nations stopped buying from Uruguay and the standard of living began to decline. It was during this period that my grandma married my grandpa Arturo in 1960, and soon after they had three children, Miguel, Maria, and Rudy. In the early 1960s, a political movement who called themselves the Tupamaros started staging the robbing of banks, gun clubs, and other businesses, and distributed stolen food and money amongst the poor in Montevideo. When the police couldn't stop the Tupamaros, the government unleashed the military, which defeated them in a brutal counterinsurgency campaign. The military acted with a ferocity previously unknown to Uruguay. Thousands of people were arrested and many others were tortured and killed.
So I remember the day of the coup. I was very young, I was about 9 years old. We lived close to Parliament House. So on the main road, we heard heavy machinery at about 3 o'clock in the morning. And we didn't know what it was until we woke up and we heard the radio broadcast that there had been a coup.
What had been a beautiful country had become one in which no one wanted to live. As the economy was in a dreadful state, my grandpa found himself out of work for 3 years, which made him very depressed and concerned about leaving the house. Meanwhile, my grandma kept her primary school teaching position, as well as teaching adults English in the evenings. She always said that as a teacher, she felt very vulnerable, as many of her peers and pupils were being killed.
So the coup had a really big impact on us as a family, and in particular on my parents. My mother would tell us, for example, when we were in Australia, we were quite safe, of a situation, for example, when she was teaching adult migrants, she would have some very clever people that would come to her classes, and at one stage she approached one of them and said, you know, what is it that brings you here, you're so clever. The student never went back to the class, but then she saw him at a distance later on, a few weeks later, with his head shaved off, and we later learned that that was like a punishment for people who would be caught spying.
On the 25th of August in 1973, the family finally received permission to migrate to Australia under the abolishment of the White Australia policy.
So the flight into Australia was absolutely amazing because we were welcomed into a sea of ships and boats and balloons as we flew over the harbour. We didn't know it was the opening of the Opera House, so it was announced over the loudspeaker in the plane that it was in fact the opening of the Opera House, the 20th of October 1973, and that the Queen was actually present. My mother stood up and said, you know, this is not just the opening of the Opera House, this is actually a welcome to us, and everybody clapped. It was a very, very exciting welcome into Australia.
Upon arrival in Australia, they were housed at East Hills Migrant Hostel and stayed there for a year in order to establish themselves with secure jobs as well as learning the English language. They were then able to move to a home in Bankstown, and after 3 years, they were all granted citizenship, which is something my grandma has always been very proud of. Despite being disappointed at the fact that she wasn't able to continue teaching, she was able to find work quite quickly and was soon recommended for a job in Medibank, in which her educational skills, dedication and determination were all recognised. Emilia was then promoted to be the ethnic liaison officer when a new change in the health system was introduced. She helped new migrants by introducing them to Medibank and to English classes and community groups. Her desire then became to help the aged in the Spanish-speaking community, whom she believed required better services in New South Wales. And so in 1984, the Spanish-speaking Pensioners Association was formed. She met with politicians such as Barry Unsworth in order to discuss funding opportunities and then worked hard to build the first of several independent living houses and units for the Spanish-speaking elderly. My grandma worked tirelessly on these projects to help others until she retired to spend more time with her three children, their spouses, and her seven grandchildren. After the passing of her husband in 2012, she was able to live independently for some time, but has now moved into one of the Spanish-speaking homes that she helped to establish, coming full circle and living in her legacy. It's clear to me that it's a culmination of these events that occurred in her life that led to her seeking fulfillment through helping others and to always continue on, despite the many hardships she was faced with. This resilience, determination and strength has had an impact on my own identity, and I have no doubt it has also impacted on the many other lives that she touched.